All right, everybody, put your books down. Time to concentrate. My name's Steve Saladino. On behalf of Skylight Books, we welcome you. Thanks for coming out to this event. We have lots of events here at the bookstore. Pretty much every weekend we have one or two events. Coming up next weekend, you probably know Amy Gerstler. She's an amazing Los Angeles poet. She'll be here next weekend. Sunday the 27th at 5 to celebrate her new book, The Ghost Girl, which is a new book of poems. I think it's her fourth or fifth, at least her fourth from Penguin. Excellent read. Also coming up in July, we have a new schedule that hasn't been printed out yet. Actually, I should have it Tuesday. So if you guys want a new schedule, come back on Tuesday. We'll have them all up at the front counter. But I do have the original right here. And so for July, we have they're all pretty good, actually. Jeff Nicholson's coming. You might know him. His new book's called Hollywood Dodo. It's a novel. Charles Phoenix, who's a Southern California kind of historian, will be here. You might have seen his slideshows around town. They're pretty well attended, and people really love him. Jonathan Ames from New York, a very funny man. He's got a new book that's about having a valet, which I wish I had. Norman Klein, another Los Angeles historian, a wonderful man, teaches at CalArts, Art Center, Otis, USC. He'll be here. Who else is coming up? Chuck Klosterman, writes for Esquire. Jerry Stahl, he's got a new book about Fatty Arbuckle. It's a novel called I, Fatty. He'll be here July 24th. T.C. Boyle will be here at the end of the month in discussion with Bridget Hughes, who's the new editor at the Paris Review. Took over George Plimpton's place, and they'll be discussing where the Paris Review is going. It's going to be a pretty great month, actually. So come back and get a schedule. We'll have more, or check our email list, www.skylightbooks.com. And now, triple threat, third time back at Skylight Books, Thomas Frank. You probably know him as founding editor of the Baffler. Writes for Harper's and The Nation. You've read his stuff in there, and you've read his book, Commodify Your Descent. And his new book, What's the Matter with Kansas? Here's Thomas Frank to read to you.
Thanks a lot. And it is my third time back at Skylight. It's one of my favorite places to come to. And what's really funny is every time I come here, something really creepy happens to me in Los Angeles. And I was walking around. Of course, I didn't rent a car, right? So I have no way of getting around. And I was walking along on Sunset Boulevard just this morning, and someone almost ran over me in a 1957 Thunderbird convertible. It's a beautiful car, and I always, well, it doesn't matter. But anyhow, I'm always wondering what kind of car. When I do finally am run down by a car, which is certainly the way that my life is going to end, I always wonder what kind of car it's going to be, and what the person's going to have in the cup holder. And this one was drinking a culotta, and she cursed at me for getting in her way. Because the person with the car is always right, of course, right?
Not just Kansas.
No. But, Kansas City is very similar to Los Angeles in some ways. I mean, there's no public transportation. You have to drive everywhere you go. In the suburb that I grew up in, there's not even sidewalks. No pretense of it. If you walk, there's something very suspicious about you, and they bring you in for questioning. If you're caught walking, this is like, and of course people can run you down. That's no big deal. So let's see. This is my third book, What's the Matter with Kansas? And I should just say right up front that when I say What's the Matter with Kansas, the book is partially about things that happen in Kansas, but it's also Kansas is a metaphor. Kansas is this sort of long-standing journalistic convention that Kansas is like the most average place in America. And so when you want to examine some, aspect of the American character, this is one of the places that you go. It's like going to Peoria, Illinois, or Muncie, Indiana, Kansas, right? This is where Dorothy is from, right? It's the opposite of Sunset Boulevard. But all of my books are about cultural inversions since the 1960s. The one about advertising was about how Madison Avenue decided that it wasn't, they weren't conformists anymore, but in fact they were the hippest of the hip. And then One Market Under God was about how Wall Street decided that, in fact, they weren't the voice of, of great concentrated wealth, but they were the friends of the little old ladies down in Beardstown, Illinois. But this one is about the, what I think is the biggest inversion of them all. I'm going to move this forward just a little bit. the biggest inversion of them all, which I call the Great Backlash. This, by this I mean populist conservatism ever since the 1960s. And I'm going to start with an illustration of this inversion. This is from the first chapter of the book. And this is the craziest inversion that I could come up with. The poorest county in America isn't in Appalachia or in the Deep South. It's actually out in the Great Plains, in Nebraska, as it happens, a region of struggling ranchers and dying farm towns. And in the election of 2000, the Republican candidate for president, Mr. George W. Bush, carried this county by a majority of greater than 80%. Now, that puzzled me when I first read about it, and it puzzles a lot of the people that I've told it to. For us, it's always the Democrats that are supposed to be the party of the workers and the poor and the weak and the victimized, right? Figuring this out, we think, is basic. This is part of the ABCs of adulthood. And when I told a friend of mine about that impoverished High Plains county that's so enamored of President Bush, she was perplexed, and she asked me this: how can anyone who's ever worked for someone else vote Republican? How could so many people get it so wrong? I thought that her question was apt. In fact, I think in some ways it's the preeminent question of our times. People getting their fundamental interests wrong is what American political life is all about. This species of derangement, if you will, is the bedrock of our civic order. This is the foundation on which everything else rests. This derangement has put the Republicans in charge of all three branches of government. It's elected presidents, senators, governors. It shifts the Democrats to the right and then impeaches Bill Clinton just for fun, just throws that in as a bonus. If you earn over $300,000 a year, you owe a great deal to this derangement. Raise a glass sometime to those indigent High Plains Republicans as you contemplate your good fortune, because it's thanks to their self-denying votes that you are no longer burdened by the estate tax or by troublesome labor unions or meddling banking regulators. Thanks to the allegiance of those sons and daughters of toil, you're able to buy two Rolexes this year instead of one and take that tour of Indochina by sedan chair. I need water. I'm a big water drinker. I just came from Wichita, and there it's not fluoridated. You know why? Have you ever heard of the John Birch Society? Yeah. Two of the founding members of the Birch Society were a big businessman in Wichita. We'll talk about that later. Anyhow, so I'm talking about how the person who makes over $300,000 a year, you know, and you get to have the two Rolexes, huh? Right. Or perhaps, and I've totally ruined it, perhaps you're one of the many, many millions of average Americans who see nothing deranged about this phenomenon at all. And for you, this picture of hard times conservatism makes perfect sense. And it's the opposite phenomenon, right? Working class people who insist on voting for liberals that strikes you as an indecipherable puzzlement. Maybe you see it the way a bumper sticker I once spotted in Kansas City puts it: a working person that supports Democrats is like a chicken that supports Colonel Sanders. Maybe you were one of those people who stood up for America way back in 1968, sick and tired of hearing those rich kids in beads badmouth the country every night on TV. Maybe you knew exactly what Richard Nixon meant when he talked about the silent majority, you know, the people whose hard work was rewarded with nothing but insults from the network news and the know-it-all college professors. None of them interested in anything you had to say. Or maybe it was the liberal judges that got you mad as hell, you know, casually rewriting the laws of your state according to some idea they'd picked up at a cocktail party, or ordering your town to shoulder some billion-dollar desegregation scheme that they had dreamed up all on their own, or turning criminals loose to prey on the hardworking and the industrious. Maybe it was Ronald Reagan that pulled you into the conservative swirl with that way that he had of talking about that sunshiny Glenn Miller America that you remembered from the time before everything went to hell. Or maybe you were pushed. Maybe it was Bill Clinton made a Republican out of you with his patently phony compassion and his obvious contempt for average non-Ivy League Americans, the ones he had the nerve to order into combat even though he himself took the coward's way out when his turn came. This great movement to the right that I'm describing is so familiar, I think that probably everybody in this room has a conversion story of some kind that they can tell. How their dad, say, had been a Union Steel worker and a stalwart Democrat, but how all their brothers and sisters started voting Republican one day. Or how their cousin gave up on Methodism and started going to the Pentecostal church out on the edge of town. Or how they themselves just got so sick and tired of being scolded for eating meat or for wearing clothes emblazoned with Chief Alinawek that one day Fox News started to seem fair and balanced to them after all. Y'all don't know who Chief Alinawek is, do you? They talk about, he's the University of Illinois mascot. And anyhow, they talk about him on Fox News all the time. Who cares, right? Anyhow, each of these are expressions of what I call in the book the Great Backlash, which is a style of conservatism that first came snarling onto the national stage in response to the partying and the protests of the late 1960s. While earlier forms of conservatism used to emphasize fiscal sobriety, the backlash mobilizes voters with explosive social issues, you know, summoning up our outrage over everything from busing to blasphemous art, which it then marries to pro-business economic policies. So cultural anger is marshaled to achieve economic ends, and it's these economic achievements that are the movement's greatest monuments. The backlash is what has made possible the great international free market consensus of recent years with all the privatization and deregulation and deunionization that are its components. The backlash is what ensures that Republicans will continue to be elected to office even when their free market miracles fail and their libertarian schemes don't deliver and their new economy collapses in ruins. The backlash is what has made possible the policy pushers' glorious fantasies of globalization and a free trade empire that are foisted on the rest of the world with such self-assurance. Because some artist decides to shock the hicks by dunking Jesus in urine, every country on earth has had to remake its economy along the lines preferred by the Republican Party USA. Now, the great backlash that I've been describing has made the laissez-faire revival possible. But this doesn't mean that it speaks to us in the manner of the capitalists of old, you know, invoking the divine right of money or demanding that the lowly learn their place in the great chain of being. On the contrary, the backlash tells us that it is a foe of the elite, that it's the voice of the unfairly persecuted, that it's a righteous protest of the people on history's receiving end. That its champions today, in fact, control all three branches of government matters not a whit. That its greatest beneficiaries are, in fact, the wealthiest people on the planet does not give it pause. In fact, backlash leaders systematically downplay the importance of economics. The movement's basic premise is that culture outweighs economics as a matter of public concern, that values matter most, as one backlash title put it. And on these grounds, it rallies citizens who would once have been reliable partisans of the New Deal to the standard of conservatism. Now, once conservatives are in office, however, and as we all know, the only old-fashioned situation they really seem to care to revive is the economic one of low wages and lax regulations. And over the last three decades, they have smashed the welfare state, they've reduced the tax burden on corporations and the wealthy, and they have generally returned the United States to a 19th century pattern of wealth distribution. So thus we have the primary contradiction of the backlash. This is a working-class movement that has done incalculable, historic harm to working class people. The leaders of the backlash may talk Christ, but they walk corporate. Values may matter most to their voters, but they always take the back seat to the needs of money when once the elections are won. And this is a basic earmark of the phenomenon, absolutely consistent across its 36-year history. Abortion is never halted. School prayer never returns. The culture industry is never forced to clean up its act. Now, this is vexing for people like me that want to write about the phenomenon, and you might expect it to vex the movement's true believers even more, right? Their grandstanding leaders never deliver. Their fury just mounts and mounts and mounts, and nevertheless, they turn out every 2 years to return their right-wing heroes to office for a second, a third, a 20th try. The trick never ages. The illusion never seems to wear off. You vote to stop abortion, and you receive a rollback in capital gains taxes. You vote to make our country strong again, and you receive deindustrialization. You vote to get those politically correct college professors, and you receive electricity deregulation. You vote to get government off our backs, you receive conglomeration and monopoly everywhere from media to meatpacking. You vote to stand tall against terrorists, and you get Social Security privatization. You vote to strike a blow against elitism, and you receive a social order in which wealth is more concentrated than ever before in our lifetimes, in which workers have been stripped of power, and CEOs are today rewarded in a manner that is beyond imagining. Like a French Revolution in reverse, in which the sans-culottes pour down the streets demanding more power to the aristocracy, the backlash pushes the spectrum of the acceptable to the right, further to the right. And having rolled back the landmark economic reforms of the 1960s and those of the 1930s, its leaders now turn their guns on the accomplishments of the earliest years of progressivism, things like the estate tax of Woodrow Wilson and the antitrust regime of Theodore Roosevelt. With a little more effort, I think the backlash may well repeal the entire 20th century. That's a joke. Anyhow, as a formula for holding together a dominant political coalition, the backlash seems so improbable and so self-contradictory that liberal observers often have trouble believing it's actually happening. For the Republican Party to present itself as the champion of working class America strikes them as such an egregious reversal of political tradition that they just dismiss the whole phenomenon. They don't want to think about it. And they brush it off. And they don't take it seriously. They say that the great backlash, it's nothing but crypto racism, or a disease of the elderly, or the random gripings of religious rednecks, or the protests of angry white men feeling left behind by history. But I think that to understand the backlash in this way is to miss its power as an idea and its broad popular vitality. I mean, it keeps on a-coming despite everything. It's, you know, a plague of bitterness capable of spreading from the old to the young, from Protestant fundamentalists to Catholics and Jews, and from the angry white man to every demographic shading imaginable. And it matters not at all that the forces that triggered the original backlash back in the 60s have long since disappeared from American life. The backlash roars on, undiminished, its rage carrying easily across the decades. Think about it. The confident liberals that led America back in the 1960s and the 50s and the 40s and the 30s are a dying species. The new left, with its gleeful obscenities and its contempt for the flag, is pretty much extinct altogether. The whole affluent society, with its, you know, paternalistic corporations and powerful labor unions, fades further into the ether with each passing year. And yet the backlash continues to dream its terrifying dreams of national decline, epic lawlessness, and betrayal at the top, regardless of what's actually going on in the world. Now, I've been on this book tour for 2 weeks now, and I watch CNN all the time. And when that's the way you look at the world, you know, through the lens of CNN, it often seems like a very rational place, a place where the world is, you know, everything works. Everyone gets to work on time, the airplanes are all on schedule, you know, and everyone strides through the office with such confidence and purpose. And it looks like, you know, an age of reason, a new economy that we're living in, with the websites singing each to each, and with a mall down the way that every week has miraculously anticipated our subtly shifting tastes, and with a global economy whose rich rewards just keep flowing. But I think that on closer inspection, this country that we live in sometimes seems more like a panorama of madness and delusion worthy of Hieronymus Bosch, of sturdy blue-collar patriots reciting the pledge while they strangle their own life chances, of small farmers proudly voting themselves off the land, of devoted family men carefully seeing to it that their children will never be able to afford proper health care or even college, of working class guys in Midwestern cities cheering as they deliver up a landslide for a candidate whose policies will end their way of life, will transform their entire region into a rust belt, will smash their hometown and strike people like them blows from which they will never recover. Anyhow, that's the first chapter. It puts a smile on your face, doesn't it? Now, here's the question: should we keep going, or should we just stop right here and ask questions? I mean, because I feel bad about leaving it on such a sour note, you know. Keep going.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
You have anecdotes.
Sorry?
Didn't you have more?
I have anecdotes. The anecdotes will come up. You'll see. Okay. So, how do we explain all these things? How are we supposed to square this circle? How is it that our conservative rebels, that we have so many of in the Midwest and also here in Orange County, how is it that our conservative rebels can profess to hate elites, but somehow to excuse from their fury the corporate world, even when it's so manifestly screwed them over? How can they find recruits for an uprising of the common people that only makes the upper crust crustier than ever? How do they decide that one man, i.e. John Kerry, yachtsman, is a Frenchified snob for being rich, but that the riches of another guy, i.e. George W. Bush, regular fellow, show him to be, you know, an average guy that you'd want to meet on the street? How do they figure that out? How do they do that? Now, I want to suggest, and this is what the book is about, is explaining all this mystery. I want to suggest that at the center of all of this is a way of thinking about social class that both encourages class hostility and that simultaneously denies the economic basis of the grievance. Class, the conservatives will tell you, is not really about money or birth or even occupation. It is primarily a matter of authenticity, that most valuable cultural commodity. I mean, you just drive down Sunset Boulevard and they're selling, you know, every manner of authenticity to replace, because you obviously don't have it. You know, that's what our culture industry runs on. But the conservatives have decided that their voters, in fact, are the bearers of, they have authenticity. They're, you know, your average Americans from your red states, from out in the heartland. And they say that class is about the kind of car that you drive and where you shop, i.e. Walmart instead of, I don't know, Trader Joe's or something like that. That class is about how you pray and only secondarily about the job that you do or the income that you make. And so what makes you a member of the noble proletariat, according to the conservative vision, is not work, but unpretentiousness, humility, and all the rest of the kind of Boy Scout virtues that our pundits are always claiming to spot out in the red states in places like Kansas. The producer class, they tell us, doesn't care about unemployment or a dead-end life or a boss that makes 500 times as much as they do. No. Out in the red states, both workers and their bosses are supposed to be united in righteous disgust at all those affected college boys at the next table, prattling on about French cheese and villas in Tuscany and the big ideas for running things that they read in books. So these are the real parasites, right? Not Enron, not Halliburton, not Merrill Lynch. It's you. It's me, intellectuals, college students. Now, the key to this repackaging of social class is the notion of a liberal elite. Now, you've heard this term before, right? It goes way back. I was just reading in the newspaper the other day, they were interviewing Newt Gingrich about 9/11, and somehow he got in a jab at the liberal elite. I don't remember exactly what the logic was, but, you know, they deserved it, and he gave it to them. Anyhow. This idea of the liberal elite has taken many forms over the years since it was basically invented by Richard Nixon and Spiro Agnew. But in its basic outlines, the grievance has always remained the same. Our culture and our schools and our government, backlashers tell us, are controlled by an overeducated ruling class that is contemptuous of the beliefs and the practices of the masses, of the ordinary people. Those who run America, the theory holds, are despicable, self-important show-offs. They are effete, to use one of Agnew's favorite terms. They are arrogant. They are snobs. They are, in a word, liberals. Now, conservatism, on the other hand, is supposed to be the doctrine of the oppressed majority. unlike classical Burkean conservatism, the backlash doesn't defend some established order of things. It accuses, it rants, it points out hypocrisies and gleefully pounces on contradictions. And while liberals are always supposed to be using their control of the airwaves and the newspapers and the schools to persecute average Americans, the Republicans are supposed to be the party of the disrespected, the downtrodden, the forgotten men. They're always the underdog, always in rebellion against a haughty establishment, always rising up from below, or at least that's how they see themselves. So all claims on the right, in other words, now advance from victimhood. And this is my most important point. This is why backlashers revel in fantasies of their own marginality and persecution. I should pause for a moment here and tell you that for the last 2.5 years, I've been immersing myself in backlash culture. I'm like on their listservs all the time, and I read the Wall Street Journal every day, and used to subscribe to all their magazines. And of course, Fox News is always on in my apartment. And what I mean by this culture of marginality and persecution is, like, on their listservs, it's not uncommon to read missives in which conservatives will greet fellow conservatives with phrases like this. They call one another fellow rubes of the flyover. And you find the same thing in their magazines. There's a magazine published in D.C. called The American Enterprise, published by the American Enterprise Institute, and these are, as it happens, the people who gave you the war against Iraq. This is the think tank that all of these guys came out of, Wolfowitz and the whole bunch. And when they were doing one of their Red State stories, it started out with these words. This is a story about Red State America. I'm stupid. And if you're reading this, you probably are too. So these are the people that are over there destroying Iraq, right? And they're the victims because liberals are always sneering at them, right? That just blows me away. Then there's that all too common spectacle that you see of conservatives boasting of their own subversiveness. They love to use the phrase politically incorrect to describe themselves. In fact, it's even the title of a book by Ralph Reed, the leader of the Christian Coalition, a really lousy book, as it happens. John Leo, who is a conservative columnist for U.S. News and World Report, wrote a book in 1994 that he called Two Steps Ahead of the Thought Police. See, they're coming to get him, right? They're coming after him. And then in the year 2001, he wrote another book that he called Incorrect Thoughts, which, as it happens, is also the title of a 1981 album by the punk rock band The Subhumans, which I listened to a lot while I was writing this book. Anyhow, the object of all of this breast-beating underdoggery is not to unvictimize the average Americans for whom conservatism claims to speak. Now, that is ruled out from the get-go. Now, while most of us in this room would think of politics, you know, if you had to define it, it's like a Machiavellian exercise in which actors make alliances and take practical steps to advance their material interests. But the backlash is something very different from that. It is a crusade in which your material interests are suspended in favor of vague cultural grievances that are both all important and yet incapable of ever being assuaged. Now, I'm not exaggerating this. When the conservative movement's leaders pick their cultural battles, okay, and remember, these are very canny people, the leaders of the conservative movement, very intelligent people, and they're responsible, for example, for such masterpieces of political strategy as the Florida 2000 election result. You know, they can be very, very clever and manipulative when they want to. But when they choose their cultural battles, they always choose battles where victory is more or less impossible, where their followers' feelings of powerlessness will simply be dramatized and their alienation heightened. Take, for example, the backlash fury object du jour while I was writing most of the book, which was the Alabama Ten Commandments monument. Remember that? It was just a little more than a year ago. And it was, remember, there was a judge that erected a Ten Commandments monument inside a courthouse deliberately in order to provoke an ACLU lawsuit. Now, everybody knew as soon as he put that thing up that this would come to no other possible end than being pried loose and carted away. Everybody knew that. And yet, nonetheless, he mobilized thousands of people, and they took turns. You know, they held vigils outside the courthouse and all that kind of thing. Or take, for example, the great abortion controversy, which mobilizes millions of people and has totally remade the politics of my home state of Kansas, but which can't be put to rest without a Supreme Court decision overturning Roe v. Wade. As culture war, the backlash was born to lose. its goal is not to win cultural battles, but to take offense, conspicuously, vocally, flamboyantly, getting mad. This is what conservative politics are all about. Indignation is the great aesthetic principle of backlash culture. I mean, everything seems to piss these people off. And they react not by getting unpissed off, but by documenting and cataloging their disgust. This is what they do. This is how they spend their time. And the result, and I know this because I read so much of their stuff. Anyhow, the result is what I call the plenty plaint, which is this way they have of amassing lots and lots and lots of petty, unrelated beefs with the world. Now, the purpose of the plenty plaint is not to evaluate the hated liberal culture that surrounds us. Instead, you know, it's a horizontal rather than a vertical mode of criticism, and its aim is not to evaluate but to infuriate us with dozens and hundreds and thousands of stories of the many, many tiny ways in which the culture that surrounds us assaults family values, you know, uses obscenities, disrespects parents, and so on, foments revolution, you know. The plenty plaint winds us up. It never offers any resolution. Its purpose is simply to remind us that we can never win. This is the rhetorical device that makes Bill O'Reilly's show such a hit. I don't know if anybody out here watches Bill O'Reilly, but he gets all indignant. This is what he does. The show starts, O'Reilly gets mad. They bring out something, it makes him mad. And that's what you watch, O'Reilly getting mad, and then it's forgotten, and the next day he gets mad about something else. And I was watching what he gets mad about, you know, the insane clown posse, for example, or then the Man-Boy Love Association. I had to look that one up. I didn't believe it existed, but man, it made him angry. Anyhow, although it typically describes only the most superficial aspects of American life, the obvious implication of the plenty plaint is that liberalism can be held responsible for the world around us, that each of these objections to the way that people drive, the way they cut it, by the way, that woman that ran over me, almost ran over me, I bet she was a liberal, damn it. The liberalism, right, the way people drive, the way they talk with their mouth full, the way they cut in line, each of these is somehow an indictment of the left. It doesn't matter that liberals have long since lost their power over government. In the backlash mind, liberalism is still what changes our mores, what determines what's on TV and in the magazines, and what makes, or rather, interprets the laws. There is nothing, not the Constitution, not guns, not electoral victories, nothing can protect us from liberalism or slow it down. It is an alien, conspiratorial force that cannot be held accountable and that doesn't care when its projects go awry. So viewed through the eyes of the backlash, liberalism's impositions are so intolerable and so bizarre and taken with so little regard for the sensibilities of the regulated that it literally will stop at nothing. I mean, who knows what precedent the Supreme Court's going to pull out of its ass next? Or which figure of everyday speech the commissars of political correctness will criminalize, even as they enlarge the list of swear words permissible for broadcast on TV, one of which swear word I just uttered. Backlash culture abounds with bizarre speculations about what atrocity the liberals are going to inflict on us tomorrow, you know, with each wild suggestion made and received with complete seriousness. Check it out. The liberal elite is going to outlaw major league sports. They're going to forbid red meat. They're going to mandate special holidays for transgendered war veterans. I didn't make any of these up, by the way. They're going to hand our neighborhood over to an Indian tribe. They're going to decree that only gay couples can adopt children. They're going to ban the Bible. In fact, on one listserv I was on, there was actually a dispute over whether or not the Bible had already been banned in Canada, you know, which is like Canada. They speak French up there, right? The liberals are just running wild in Canada. Anyhow, to believe that liberalism is all-powerful makes for a singularly negative and depressing movement culture. To be a populist conservative is to be a fatalist. To believe in a world where your side can never win, indeed where your side almost by definition cannot win, where even the most shattering electoral victories always turn out to be hollow, and the liberal stranglehold on life can never be broken. One of the images that always comes up in backlash culture is of a face that is bound and gagged. Conservatives believe that they dare not speak, that they're not allowed to speak, always for fear of having the H-bomb charges of racism or sexism dropped on them. So liberalism is like an undeterred superpower. Conservatives are without agency, they believe. Conservatives are hapless victims adrift in a fatalistic universe where only liberals have the power to act, and where every act undertaken by those liberals is an imposition on the good people of Middle America. Now, what's funny is that this negative movement culture is genuinely attractive in some ways, and even seductive, and it draws you in. For one thing, it gets conservative lawmakers immediately off the hook for their flagrant failure to make any headway in the culture wars. More importantly, though, I think it offers conservatives an attractive way of dealing with an unfair universe. The backlash provides its followers a ready-made identity in which the glamour of authenticity combined with the narcissism of victimhood becomes available to almost anybody that wants to sign up. You're the salt of the earth, the very beating heart of America, Fox News tells all of those, you know, cranky suburbanites that tune in. And yet you are unfairly and outrageously persecuted. So in some ways, I think backlash culture resembles the most vulgar kind of post-colonial theory. Whatever the issue, it tells its followers, you are not at fault. You're always a victim, besieged by this hateful overclass from the East Coast, or worse, from France, right? Just like in West Africa, always pressing their alien ways down on you. Conservative culture absolves people of responsibility for what goes on around them. It excuses them for their failures. It makes them feel noble, and it allows them both in politics and in private life to resolve disputes by pointing their fingers at the outside world and blaming it all on a depraved liberal elite. Now, none of what I have described so far would make any sense were it not for a critical rhetorical move that conservatives then take, which is the systematic erasure of the economic. Now, as we all know, some species of conservative are always very happy to talk about economics. You can find them any day of the week at the University of Chicago Economics Department or any management school in the country or on the op-ed page of the Wall Street Journal, prattling on about the mystical inerrancy of the free market and the benevolence of global capitalism. But most of the conservatives that I discuss in this new book don't have much to say about the business world at all. Ann Coulter, for example, has a whole book about media distortions. You know, it's called Slander. But when she comes across the subject of Enron, she just dismisses it. It's like, just to mention Enron, to talk about Enron at all, means that you are a lying, twisting liberal, you know. Anyhow, the erasure of the economic is a necessary precondition for backlash ideas. It's only possible to think, for example, that the news is slanted to the left if you don't take into account who owns the news media, and if you never turn your critical eye on CNBC or the business section of every newspaper in America. The university campus also can only be imagined as a place dominated by leftists if you never consider econ departments or business schools. Most importantly, it's only possible to understand popular culture as the product of liberalism if you have blinded yourself to the most fundamental economic reality, namely that the networks and the movie studios and the ad agencies and the publishing houses and the record labels are, in fact, commercial enterprises, as everyone in this city knows. Now, in some ways, I think the backlash vision of the way the world works is nothing more than an old-fashioned leftist vision, and I mean really old-fashioned leftist vision of the world, but with the economics drained out, where the muckrakers of 100 years ago used to fault capitalism for botching this institution and that, the backlash simply changes the script to blame liberalism. So, for example, until the late 1960s, the standard critique of the press that you heard in the United States, this is from everyone from Upton Sinclair to A.J. Liebling, was that newspapers tilted to the right, serving the interests of the capitalists who advertised in them and the capitalists who published them, you know? William Randolph Hearst, or Colonel McCormick, or what's the guy here in Los Angeles?
Hearst.
Otis. Yeah, the Otis family. Yeah. Chandler, that was their name. Otis. Yeah, that's what they called him, right? Anyhow, doesn't matter. Today, though, as everyone knows, it's liberals, liberal reporters and liberal editors who are always supposed to be twisting the news to match their elitist personal preferences. And the same treatments are handed out to old leftist critiques of higher education, the legal establishment, the foreign policy world, architecture, and of course government itself, with each of these institutions now said to be a slavish servant, not of the interests, as they used to say back in the 30s, but of liberalism. Even the rhetoric of the backlash, with all of its, you know, tough guy flourishes, sometimes appears to have been lifted whole cloth from the proletarian 1930s.
Any direct quotes from them?
From the conservatives? I think we'll come to a few here in a minute. But one of my hobbies is reading proletarian literature. It was this short-lived, like, fictional fad back in the 1930s. You know, a fad in the literary world. And if you and I spend a lot of time reading this. And if you put that down next to a book by Ann Coulter, say, or something, they're very, very similar. For example, the idea that average people are helpless pawns caught in a machine run by the elite, I mean, comes straight out of the vulgar Marxist copybook, which taught generations of party members that they inhabited a deterministic world where agency was reserved for capitalists only, or more precisely, for capital itself. And as we all know, the old school proletarian writers loved nothing more than to mock the Frenchified pretensions of the effete, devitalized upper classes. Just read an article or two by Mike Gold, the literary editor of the Daily Worker, and then pick up something by David Brooks or you know, Rush Limbaugh, and you'll see they just turn these stereotypes on liberals. Now. At least it has fluoride, damn it. Okay. Now it gets good. Now we've been through all the difficult stuff. Okay. Now one problem that the old left didn't have was explaining how the world worked. Class struggles, they thought, could pretty much explain everything. But if you drain the economics out of out of the world, you're left with very few tools for explaining anything. Why is our culture the way it is? Why does TV get coarser with each passing year? What makes certain styles or words or ideas suddenly so visible while others disappear? Each of these is a matter of dark, bitter obsession among backlash conservatives, and yet the only answer that they can ever come up with is to blame liberalism. Our culture is the way it is because manipulative liberals have made it so. Now the truth is that the culture that surrounds us and that persistently triggers new explosions of backlash outrage every couple of years is largely the product of business rationality. As we all know, it's made by writers and actors who answer to editors and directors and producers, who answer to senior vice presidents and CEOs, who answer to Wall Street bankers who demand profits above everything else. And from the mega mergers of the media giants to the commercial timeouts during the football game to the plots of the Hollywood movies and the cyber fantasies of Wired and Fast Company, we live in a free market world. The Supreme Court doesn't make American culture. Neither does Planned Parenthood or even the mighty ACLU. It's business that speaks to us over the TV set, always in the throbbing tones of cultural insurgency, you know, forever shocking the squares, humiliating the pious, queering tradition, and crushing patriarchy. It's because the demands of consumerism that our TV is such a sharp-tongued insulter of family values and such a zealous promoter of every species of social deviance. It's thanks to new economy capitalism and its cult of novelty and creativity that our bankers today refer to themselves as revolutionaries, which they do, and our discount brokerages tell us that owning stock will smash conformity and usher in the rock and roll millennium, which they also do. I mean, we're encouraged to drink Dr. Pepper because it's going to make us more of an individual. and consume Starbucks because it's so goddamn authentic, right? To pierce our navels and ride souped-up jet skis and eat Jell-O because these are all such extreme experiences, like the extreme SUV that I saw the other day. Counterculture is so ordinary and so commercial and so business-friendly today that there's actually a school of urban theorists now that thrives by going around the country and instructing municipal authorities on the fine points of luring artists, hipsters, and rock bands to their cities on the grounds that where these groups go, corporate offices will follow. And I'm not making this up. It's true. They've even been, I'm sure they've been here in this very bookstore. The free market doesn't respect family values any more than it respects the integrity of the small towns out in the Lone Prairie, or the architecture of Detroit, or the well-being of Boeing workers down in Wichita. The free market is a destroyer, not a conserver. All that is solid, it melts into air. I think ordinary working class people are right to hate the culture that we live in. I think they're right to feel that they have no power over it, and to notice that it makes them feel inadequate and stupid. The middle Americans, after all, these are the people that the ads and the sitcoms and the movies warn us against. They're the prudish preacher who forbids dancing. Remember Footloose, right? They're the dullard husband who foolishly consumes Brand X. They're the square cowboy that gets gunned down by the alternative cowboy. They're the hard hat who just doesn't get it, as every TV commercial in the 1990s wanted to tell you. Now, conservatives are good at complaining about all of these things. What they refuse to think about are the forces that create the problem. Take, for example, the backlash hero Gary Aldrich. He wrote this book called Unlimited Access, about how he worked for the White House and then under Clinton, and how much he hated Clinton and all the people that worked for Clinton, and what slobs they were. This is basically the point of the book. You know, these long, silly complaints about how they eat too much or their offices are too messy and this kind of thing. And at one point, he says that that liberals, one of the problems with liberals is that they think it's oppressive to have to wear a tie. Now, Aldrich is correct in noticing that in the 90s there was a movement against formal dress in the white-collar workplace. We all know this, right? Where he goes wrong is when he attributes this change, as he does, to leftist traitors boring from within. And this is a classic backlash explanation, right? The reason that they want casual dress in the workplace is because they're communists. Now, as everybody knows, as everybody who had a job in the 1990s remembers, the kind of people who thought casual dress was so, you know, great, they weren't communists. They were the hyper-capitalist heroes of the new economy, right? The self-proclaimed business revolutionaries who benefited most handsomely from the votes of angry conservatives everywhere. It's not because radicals have secretly taken over the world that, you know, people like the intensely anal Gary Aldrich feel so uncomfortable. It's because the new turbocharged capitalism has no place for the hyper-orderly gray flannel people like him, and it tells him this every chance it gets. It tweaks a nation of squares in all of its signature cultural outlets, whether it's management books, TV commercials, and Tom Peters PowerPoint presentations. Tom Peters PowerPoint presentations. Listen, consumer capitalism's only use for such ramrod straight men is in showing them to be, you know, visibly upset by the liberating potential of some corn chip, you know? Inveighing against some brand of soda pop because it breaks the rules or lets the consumer be too much of an individual or tastes too outrageous or whatever that is. But the backlash can never see it that way. Our culture is the way it is because liberals have made it so. And this is the logical terminus of backlash reasoning. When you've rejected all of the accepted social science methods for understanding the way things work, when you can't talk straight about social class, when you can't acknowledge that free market forces might not always be for the best, when you can't admit even the most basic historical truths, these blunt tools are all that you're left with. Journalists and historians and sociologists and anthropologists and musicians and architects and all the rest of them do what they do because they are liberals. And liberals lie. You know, liberals cheat. Liberals do anything, in fact, that promises to advance their larger partisan project, that is, to create more liberals and thus to win. So liberalism isn't a product of social forces, like the environmental movement and the labor movement and that sort of thing. Liberalism is a social force. It is a juggernaut moving according to a logic all its own, as rigid and as mechanical as anything dreamed up by the Stalinists of yesterday. Now, the great backlash started in the late 60s with the coming together of two very different political factions: the traditional business-minded Republicans with their faith in the free market, and the working class middle Americans who signed on to preserve family values. Now, for the first group, for the business-minded people, the conservative revival of the last 36 years has been fantastically rewarding. After all, they're wealthier as a class today than ever before in their lifetimes. But for the other group, for the aggrieved middle Americans, I think the experience has been pretty much a bummer all around. All they have to show for their Republican loyalty are lower wages, more dangerous jobs, dirtier air, a new overlord class that comports itself like King Farouk, and, of course, a shit culture whose moral freefall continues without significant interference from the grandstanding Christers that they insist on sending triumphantly back to Washington every couple of years. By all rights, the charm of republicanism should have worn off for this part of the conservative coalition a long, long time ago. I mean, after all, how can you lament the shabby state of American life while absolving business of any responsibility for it? How can you complain so bitterly about culture and yet neglect to mention the main factor making our culture what it is? How can you reconcile the two clashing halves of the conservative mind? By believing in an all-powerful liberal elite. That's how. Alone among the many, many businesses of the world, the backlash thinkers tell us, the culture industry just does not respond to market forces. It does the ugly things that it does because it is biased by robotic, alien liberals always trying to drip their corrosive liberalism into our ears. Liberal bias exists because it must exist in order for the rest of contemporary conservatism to make sense. As with St. Anselm's proof of the existence of God, which flummoxed generations of our ancestors, it simply cannot be any other way. Liberal bias has to be. Therefore, it is. Thank you very much. I'm glad they turned on the air conditioning there. Good move with the air con. Okay, now questions. And I'm sorry, I only had one good juicy quote from conservatives. I cut all the rest of them out.
Are there any indications that all these, that backlash politics aren't a deliberate machination that, like, pull the culture war card so we can, you know, screw the little guy by garnering these votes?
I mean, I don't know about that, but I mean, there's many levels where there's a lot of strategizing. I mean, the people who run Fox News obviously, strategize about it, but they're not interested in a maneuver like that. But you know that people like Grover Norquist, who's a very powerful player in Washington, sits down with other conservatives once a week, and they figure out what they're going to do. And you know that they're, you know, while Bush has been very successful pushing, you know, repealing this tax and that, and doing all the things that he's done, they're looking for an issue that's going to win the next campaign. And they, you know, they're like, well, it's going to be gay marriage. Clearly, that's the thing that's going to wind up your middle Americans and maybe even your Latino voters and bring them into the backlash coalition. But I don't think anybody plans it that way. That's just the way it's worked out. But I think they do deliberately choose culture war issues that are just screaming into the wind. You know, railing against Hollywood, for example. It doesn't matter. You can elect that Congress can be 100% Republican, and they're not going to change the way Hollywood does business. You know, it answers to other forces. It doesn't answer to Congress. The idea is ridiculous. Yeah.
You may have answered this question. Bumper sticker length question I'm fond of asking is, how much money does it take before it makes sense to vote Republican? Can you?
That's good. That's a good question. I actually don't know, but I do know.
You mentioned 300K.
That's because that's the top. I use that because that's the top income tax bracket. Yeah, and their taxes have dropped from when Reagan was elected. Their taxes, I think, were like 70%, and today they're like 20-something percent. So it's really really good times to be in that income tax bracket. But you know, it's pretty much always good times to be. But anyhow, it's much better times now.
So many people who vote who can't take advantage of having that kind of income, and yet do, and you're addressing that.
Right, exactly.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, that's what it's about.
What you were saying, Denny Hastert, the speaker, recently said something along the line of, well, you don't realize how difficult it is to run a government when you control all three branches.
Did he really say that?
Yes, in the last couple of weeks.
Yeah. Let's see, I had something clever I was going to say, but I've forgotten what it was. I know what it is. I do know this, that the conservative revolution is permanently changing, maybe not permanently, but is drastically changing the way, you know, American society looks. I mean, massive inequality. And I wrote an article for Harper's. I've been in a very bad cynical mood for a number of years. And I wrote an article called Get Rich or Get Out. Which farmers say this in Kansas, they say either get big or get out, because you can't be a small farmer anymore. You either have to get big or die. And that's basically the way this country is going. You know, get rich or forget about it. It's not your country anymore. This is a country for rich people. This is a country where every benefit that, you know, every good thing that life has to offer goes to one group of people, and everybody else, fuck them. That's the way.
That's how it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you think of someone like Pat Buchanan, who practiced backlash and then started moving toward economic populism?
Buchanan fascinates me because he wrote a lot of those, like the nattering nabobs of negativism. This is one of Agnew's lines from the 60s. Buchanan wrote it, and now here he is 30 years later to pick up the pieces and like try to be the voice of the angry, you know, angry working class that his policies have screwed. You know, the very people that have been, you know, screwed over. But anyhow, he fascinates me. But he's not much of an economic populist. He wants protectionism, but that's about it. He's not a liberal, and he's certainly not FDR style, you know, progressive. He's nowhere on the labor issues. He just has this one thing, and that is protectionism, and it's just not enough. Okay, somebody else. Yeah.
How canny are these guys like O'Reilly running Republican Radio, and who is behind that? Are those the same suburban Reaganites from Orange County? Who are these people who, I don't know if you're familiar with the radio waves in California, but they're very powerful and plugged right into this manifesto style that you're, you know, so articulate.
Well, I have followed the radio, what's happened in the radio industry a little bit, just because some of my colleagues back in Chicago are in the radio business. And why is it only conservatives who are on the radio? Well, it's a very interesting question. And for one thing, it is, of course, because of the management and the ownership of the radio stations, and that they like someone like Rush Limbaugh, whereas giving me someone like me a radio show is like, that's the last thing they would ever do. They would sooner die than do that. They'd be like, well, that's stupid. You know, he's going to get my taxes raised. That's idiotic. Of course, I'm not going to do that. You know, I disagree with the guy. But it's not a conspiracy any larger than that. That's just a programming decision that people make. I think if liberal radio was able to draw in a lot of listeners, and you know, they would treat it like any other kind of programming. One of the reasons that it's failed, and I've been on Air America now twice promoting this book, and I'm I've been following their effort. Is that it's run by the same people that run the Democratic Party in Washington, D.C. And these are people that have basically given up on working class people. Look, the secret to Rush Limbaugh and to all the rest of these people is that they talk the language of the angry working class. The Republicans have stolen this language from the Democratic Party, from the left. This is one of the reasons that Kansas is so fascinating to me, is because 100 years ago, Kansas was the homeland of populism. This was this left-wing movement in the 1890s. That basically took over Kansas. And today, the aggrieved faction in Kansas politics, uses the same language, but is on the exact opposite side of the spectrum. They're always wanting to cut taxes and do away with the farm programs, you know, all this, you know, they even want to bring back the gold standard. You know, these are things that are the exact opposite of what the populists wanted, but they do it using the same language of the angry working class. And this is what the liberals don't get. They don't understand that. I mean, this is, I could talk about this forever. It just makes me so mad.
But you've given me so much hope.
That's not what I'm here to do.
I've really scouted and listened to everybody. You are the only speaker who's really right on the pulse of what's happening. And I think that if enough Democrats hear what you're saying, we can really shake this thing up. And you are the first one to tap into it. And I applaud you, sir, because I think
you're
really
doing
a good job.
Thank you. That's very kind of you, but they don't like me. No, I did meet Howard Dean, though, the other day. And he was really nice. And he said a lot of the same things that I said. But obviously, the leadership of the Democratic Party, you know, they don't like him. They threw everything against that guy. The leadership of the Democratic Party is determined to put those days behind it, the days of Roosevelt and Truman and William Jennings Bryan. They don't want to appeal to, they don't want to be, you know, to be seen as being the party of the working class. And whenever they even start talking about inequality and those issues, Republicans say, that's class warfare, and they immediately shut up. But they also don't want to do it because they want to be able to appeal to the corporate donors. They want to be seen as being safe, you know, safe for suburban people to vote for their party. And so they don't dare use that language anymore. And the ironic thing is that Republicans use it all the time, now in a coded way, to be sure. But they forever are mocking the elite for their, you know, their Volvos and their fancy cheese. And they use class language constantly. They're the only ones out there using it. And it's extraordinary to me, but that's the way it is.
But you're showing us, and we're smart enough to take the ball you're handing us.
Thank you very much. Now, so yeah.
Unless this is too involved an answer, the Democratic Party giving up on the working class, when and how did that start to happen in America?
All of these changes started at about the same time. So the McGovern campaign in 72 was when this idea first occurred to the leaders of the big Democratic strategists. They called it the new politics, and they were going to put together a new coalition, and they didn't have to rely on organized labor. And this crashed and burned as an idea, but it was revived then in the 80s by a group called the Democratic Leadership Council, who are sort of my arch enemy. And
who gave us UNO?
Clinton, yes. Well, Clinton is their great success story. They say, Clinton got elected. Whereas Mondale, who is this classic old school liberal, you know, went down to this horrifying defeat. But Clinton got elected, see? So we delivered victory. We won for our party. But the fact is, Democrats are now the minority in both houses of Congress. That's something I thought I would never see in my life, that the party of Roosevelt was the minority party. That's extraordinary to me. But the DLC thinks of the Democratic Party. They don't think of it the way I think of it, and the way that I assume that you people think of it, which is the Democratic Party is a vehicle towards a certain, you know, certain politics, certain political ends that we want to achieve. They don't think of it that way. They think of the Democratic Party as an end in itself. It's a corporation, and it needs to first of all survive, and second of all increase its, you know, market share or its profitability. And so, the leader of the Democratic Leadership Council calls himself the CEO. You know, they love this language. They always talk about entrepreneurship and this kind of thing. But, you know, that's nothing wrong with that. The sick thing is that this way of thinking about the party leads them to this politics where they say, well, you know, if we're going to, we have to, you know, the only way you can win is by running ads on TV. Everyone knows this. And so the question becomes, how do you pay for it? How do you pay for the ads on TV? Well, you have to court the business community. You have to become safe. And so they've abandoned the economic populism in favor of fighting it out on the cultural issues. And this has just been catastrophic in a lot of places, like in Wichita. I should shut up now, but there's an anecdote in the book about how they lost Wichita, which is a very blue-collar city, had a Democratic congressman and a Democratic mayor, and when Clinton signed off on NAFTA, I mean, even union voters in that city said, well, the, you know, what is he, there's no difference between the parties anymore. If the Democrats aren't going to stand up on these economic issues, then I'm going to vote my conscience on, you know, abortion. And the Democratic, their congressman went down, and they've been Republican ever since. It's an amazing shift, and it happened all over the country. But you wanted to say something else.
Yeah, real quick follow-up to that is, wouldn't the success of the moral majority from, I think, about 84 on to the election of Ronald Reagan, including the influence of Newt Gingrich, be a counterexample to that philosophy?
Of the DLC's philosophy? Well, yeah, obviously. They're constantly trying to seek the center while the Republicans are constantly pushing to the right. And this has been very, this is another mistake that they make on the, that Kerry is making and that they make on liberal radio, is that they don't understand, you don't change the debate by always looking for the center. If the other team is constantly moving to the right, then you're going to be moving to the right too. What you do is you stake out a position on the left and you hammer back that way. You know, and you enlarge the spectrum in that direction. But these people, their idea is to not talk to the left, to be done with the left. The left is something that they want no part of. The left is embarrassing to them. Just read the New York Times someday. I don't know, because we're against the war in Iraq or something. I don't know.
Because we read books and we're threat to, you know,
we don't. Yeah, that's right, because we're the...
Can I just make a comment?
Yeah, sure.
All the things you're saying about that elitism and all that notion that these regular blue-collar workers have and is being fed by this right-wing backlash culture, some of it's kind of true because we're so fed up. Because I was tired of being put down because I was smart, because I read books, because I studied art and music, and I was passionate, and I was alive, and I wasn't a fucking idiot like everyone else. I didn't want to be a cop. You know, I don't think telling people what to do is a good idea. And so there is some of that there, and I think maybe those of us, the real progressives, need to maybe look at that in ourselves and say, well, wait, am I, you know, in fact, a snob a little bit? Because I can't help it, because if you're a fucking idiot and I'm well-educated, that's going to be, you know, and not an idiot. I mean, they're good people, and I know I have good friends, my roommate's from North Carolina. He's a Christian, and he believes in God, and he's got all this stuff, but he's also passionate, and he's a nice human being, but there's points where we're just not going to meet.
Yeah.
And politically, how do we resolve that? How do I, you know, am I lessening myself because I need to get with him and say, yes, okay, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Let's talk about business.
No, there is a way to beat it without. I don't think that liberals have to abandon any of their positions on things. Well, one of the big problem is attitudinal. Now, I wouldn't point to you as an example of the problem. That would never occur to me. But there are. I mean, look, they've just nominated another a millionaire. You know, a guy who is like from this very wealthy family to be the Democratic nominee, and you know, and you go to any kind of leftist gathering in Washington, and it is people of privilege. You know, and. There is a certain kind of person who regards being on the left as an avant-garde statement rather than as a political thing. Now, you talk to guys, think for a second about someone in a labor union or someone who is really in a, you know, really a traditional Democrat, somebody who is at the bottom, not the top. And for them, the whole point of having a left movement is to be the majority. That's, you know, the only way that you're going to win. You have to have the numbers on your side. You have to be able to, you know, to whether it's going on strike or winning elections, you know, the other team has the money, but you have the numbers. That's what it's about. And the stakes are huge. It's your health care on the line. It's your, you know, it's your benefits at work that are on the line. It's, you know, any number of very important material things, but the kind of liberals who rub me the wrong way don't see it that way. It's not about being a majority. It's about being more virtuous than other people.
Right.
And I just can't stand that. I have zero tolerance for that.
Well, it's not very civil. They're not acting like they're citizens of the country.
Yeah.
Yeah. It is elitist in a sense, because maybe because they're frustrated.
Yeah.
Because it's dirty.
These people aren't frustrated. These people are like, and that's the other thing, is that the consequences of being a minority, of not being able to run the, you know, to run the, you know, to have them, to have the numbers in Congress and wherever else, the consequences don't come home to them, because they're doing just fine. Now, I don't want to endorse any of the, you know, this vision of a liberal elite, because, you know, it is largely bullshit.
Right.
And there's, you know, the auto workers in Detroit are not members of the liberal elite. You know, sharecroppers in Alabama are not members of the liberal elite. You know, the idea is ridiculous. But the way to beat this stuff, I think it's so obvious. I think it's just incredibly obvious. You have to meet the Republican fake populism, the bizarre, the cultural populism, with the real deal, with economic populism. It would shatter. It would shatter in an instant.
Like it did in Kansas 110 years ago.
That's right, exactly. Yeah. And he said, like it did in Kansas 100 years ago.
It took off all over the place. It took off in Texas.
That's right.
It really exploded. Most of the South became populist.
Yeah. And we could do it again. It could be done.
Do we need a new code, a new language? Because I like the fact that you said that the right backlash is using coded versions of classism.
Yeah.
That's important. I mean, do we need to do that too?
No. We've got the real deal. We've got the real deal if we want to use it, you know?
Authentic.
Yeah.
You know, one thing that you didn't mention, or maybe I didn't hear you mention, is one of the things that turned this around is racism.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
There's
in 65, when LBJ, apropos of what this gentleman said, a figure you haven't mentioned is Kevin Phillips, the architect of the Southern Strategy, who is presently going on tour like you with a public apologia.
Yeah, for the Southern Strategy?
In his most recent book, he talks about how now we have aristocracies and inherited wealth. You know, Lincoln Chafee, one of the last old line liberal Republicans, the Bushes, he's even suggesting the Clintons may become one of these new lines. Now, he's really going out on a limb with that, but he calls attention to in 65 when LBJ signed the Voting Rights Act, and he made some comment having to do with this, we're forever changing the Democratic Party.
Yeah, he said, we won't win the South again and for the rest of our lives.
Right, and what the Democrats said about racism, this needs to be addressed. Because
of course.
I mean, words and, like urban means.
Right. Oh, and this is, there's many wonderful example, well, wonderful, horrifying examples of what you're describing, whether it's the Boston busing riots. And this is the backlash, you know, right down the line has been either overt racism, where you got a guy like Wallace in 68, this is the guy that basically invented the language of the backlash, or coded racism with someone like Jesse Helms, or the welfare Cadillac, or what's the Willie Horton, the commercials that Bush's dad ran.
Yeah,
and this is still used in the South with the fights over the Confederate flag and this kind of thing, and it's very common. Now, one of the things about Kansas, and this is what fascinates me, is that this stuff is not a big part of the a big issue there. Sexism, yes, that's all over the place, but this is one of the reasons that I wanted to write about Kansas, because it's the backlash, and I really searched. I could not find any kind of overt or even coded racism. In fact, the leader there, this guy called Sam Brownback, he's a U.S. senator. He's one of the only conservative Republicans that has made outreach to the Black Caucus in Congress. And there's a certain fantasy among Kansas backlashers that they are the inheritors of the mantle of John Brown, who is like this patron saint in Kansas, because this is where, you know, the fight with Missouri over slavery. And so the reason this intrigues me is because we expect the backlash, or a lot of people just expect this stuff to peter out as racism becomes more and more unacceptable, which it is, and as the you know, white part of the electorate becomes less and less significant. But the problem is that these people in Kansas are forever coming up with schemes to extend the backlash to other demographics. For blacks, for example, the issue that they've settled on two. School vouchers is one. Turn them against the educational elite, you know, the NEA and this kind of thing. And the other is Social Security, where it's this total fantasy that they've invented about Social Security being discriminatory. But they're working very hard on this. And they're trying to rope in your various demographics. And so the scary thing is, what if they invent a complaint for every demographic? What if they do that successfully? Bush is trying right now with the gay marriage thing. I mean, that's the whole point. Are you saying we're almost out of time? What are you saying? Are you just scratching your ear? Okay, yeah, back there.
I wanted to ask you about what you were saying about the Democratic Party leadership being unable to represent the constituency that it traditionally did. This seems to me something that we all know at this point. Everybody I've talked to that, you know, is semi-educated on this stuff understands that. What I'm frustrated with and what I don't understand is, at what point are we going? Do you think it would be feasible to stop trying to get the Democratic Party to do this for us and to move the critical mass into like a third party and break down the two-party system? Because it doesn't seem like it's going to change anymore. They're completely bought out.
Yeah. I'm in favor of that in theory, and you think about my favorite political movement in history, which was populism in Kansas. That was the whole point, that the two-party system, that these two parties were arguing over silly little things and ignoring the huge issue, which was corporate capitalism. What are we going to do about corporate capitalism? And the two parties were fighting over the tariff or something like that, back and forth, you know. And this had the effect of shocking one of the two parties into for fear of becoming marginal. The Democrats moved to the left and adopted a lot of the populist positions. This is what the election of 1896 was all about, and it had this dramatic effect. Okay. One of another effect that populism had was that the laws in almost every state were changed so that you couldn't have what they call fusion candidates, where one guy or woman will be endorsed by two parties, the POPs and the Democrats, for example. And so that's actually illegal in a lot of states. And they passed various other laws designed to prevent a third party from ever happening again. The problem with the way the system is set up now is that to vote for a third party candidate means to injure the main party candidate who's closest to your position. And so it's totally counterproductive. If we can change the laws, then hell yeah, of course I'd be fourth. Hell, I voted for Nader twice, you know. I'm a sucker for this sort of thing, but I think that the laws have to be changed to allow us that it's so obvious to me that the two-party system doesn't.
People who are writing the laws are Democrats, Republicans. Right. Are gonna do that.
Right. Exactly.
Politique de Pierre, that's Robespierre, that's the age. That's
the worse
terror.
The better? Is that the worse
that's
the better?
In the French Revolution was called La Politique de Pierre, making things worse.
Yeah.
I disagree, sir. When things get worse, things get worse.
Right.
Bad only
that's
looks
right.
good.
And
when
I,
worse
no, I see your point, but
change only happens when things get worse.
Right, and at some point, of course, this is what the sociologists say, that at some point we'll reach that some point people reach a breaking point and they snap back. And this is
fascist, full bore.
Exactly.
We
exactly.
can't afford that.
Well, no.
Like, take public schools. That's the cement that holds our democracy together.
Yeah.
And yes, the voucher plans which you refer to are working as a very strong. I teach in the inner city at 32nd Street School. And yes, sir, this is one of the wedges that black preachers speak to at their congregations every Sunday and Wednesday. And the rest of us are blissfully unaware of this going down.
Yeah. Yeah, but let me just say one thing about the problem, the better the worse theory, and that is that, and I do address this a little bit in the book, which is that the classic sociological theory is that things get pushed, and then you have a French Revolution situation. People are so impoverished and so angry that they lash back and they come back and they overthrow everything, and hey, well, nobody wants that. Nobody wants a cataclysm, right? So you better not let that happen. But the thing is that the backlash people seem to become more conservative as they become more immiserated. This is the lesson that we've learned from this. This is what's so deeply fucked about it. And that's why it's not gonna happen that way. The worse people get, the more they seem to like
Schwarzenegger. California elected Schwarzenegger.
I know. I couldn't believe that. I was out watching TV the other day, and they said Governor Schwarzenegger today said, and I just burst out laughing. You know. Okay, somebody else.
We have one more question.
Yeah, one more. Yeah, back there.
What do you think of the backlash thus far against Fahrenheit 9/11? Do you think it'll actually be received in Middle America?
They've been doing. I haven't seen the movie yet. I mean, no, nobody has, right? But they have, after the last one, he has become, I always liked Michael Moore. I really liked Roger and Me. I just thought that was a great movie. And but after the last one, they have done such a slander job on that guy. You know, he's become one of the liberal elite that they constantly denounce. You know, they have this, you know, litany of bad men that they go down and assail, and he's one of them now. And so I think that it probably will have less effect than he thinks it's going to, just because, you know, the well has been poisoned already, you know.
Do you think there's any way to combat that at this point?
They can all read my book. Yeah, hell yeah. But nobody's going to. Did you see? Nobody's going to read the book. Did you? You know, it's like they've. I heard Rush Limbaugh denounced me the other day. It's a, for me, that's a great achievement. But yes, I'm being denounced coast to coast. It's wonderful, or horrifying, depending on how you look at it. Well, thank you all very much for coming. Now let's drink some beer. Oh, and they. I brought my signing tent, and they have these buttons, which are very, very humorous, so you, that you can that they're giving out, right?
We got some buttons for. And so we're just going to form a line right here. We'll have Tom back here behind this desk, and you can just form a line to the left, or left.
Left.